a few years to when you were on Broadway in A Chorus Line.
A few years? More years than you were alive.
How did you get to Broadway, and then what was that whole experience like?
I knew from a very early age I wanted to do that. So all through high school and college, I trained as an actor and wanted to do it so bad. And then when I finally had the opportunity, I thought, I can get to Broadway much easier as a dancer. So out came the tights and the toe shoes, and away I went. So I studied really, really hard, really fast, and did several Broadway shows before Chorus Line. One of them was Seesaw, which is where I met Michael Bennett and his artistic and creative staff. So I was one of the dancers, Michael Bennett dancers, that was invited to the recording sessions. We sat around a big old reel-to-reel tape recorder with a couple of bottles of jug wine and just started talking. And the famous question, what made you become a dancer? What made you do this? And we basically went on till dawn and didn't finish, so we went back the next night. Started to ruminate, and then he found a maverick producer, Joseph Papp, at the Public Theater, who up to that point had basically just taken care of Shakespeare in the Park for New York beautifully. Michael went to him with this sort of concept, because it wasn't a show. It wasn't the package that you bring to a producer. Here's the book, here's the lyrics, here's the music, here's the concept, here's who I have. Did you do backers? Nothing like that at all. There was nothing. There was an idea that the kids in the chorus wanted to tell their story about, hey, what about us?
So fast forward, how did you end up in Dallas?
I was always exposed to theater. I saw my first play, The Rose Tattoo, at the Billy Rose Theater when I was like 9. So I've always exposed to great theater, and so you learn by watching. But then cutting my teeth on theater in the Broadway arena, I've worked with the best, and especially in Chorus Line, with the process of workshop, I got to see and work with and create along with everyone else. I moved here for love, temporarily, and the temporarily just kept getting extended, and life happened, and people die, and then you're responsible, your responsibilities grow, and it's now been almost 30 years and I'm still here. And so to get my fix, my theater fix, I started performing, but really I knew so much that it was hard not to say, could just try it this way, and maybe we should try this, and do you think this step would read better on 10 people? And so finally, instead of telling me to shut up, they just let me do it, and it just started to grow, and now I'm very blessed. I pretty much work constantly. I just, thank you.
So let's talk a little bit about Hank Williams. He was an American icon, but a very troubled man. Do you think there's a connection between the two?
I think it's got a foot in both of those worlds. As I said earlier, success is very difficult to deal with. It takes things out of proportion, and it's a hard beast to tame. In our show, Hank Williams' Lost Highway, it's a beautiful sort of patchwork of his life and career and music and what the music has done for America and for the world. The show has everything. It has a gift, it has mentoring, it has addiction, it has enablers, it has hard love, tough love, it has no love, it has passion, it has a drive, it has all the basic components to make a star. They're all there. But the telling of the story is so darn pleasant. And I like that, especially at the holidays.
It's been a real pleasure, Michael. Thank you.
Oh, this was so fun. Thank you so much.
It's been a pleasure. Thank you, Michael. Thank you.
Make sure you see Hank Williams.
I